What's good, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Community Voices, the first Community Voices of 2023. So, I mean, I know this is probably the deadline, but, you know, Happy New Year to everybody and everything. Hope everybody's doing good. Today, I'm joined with somebody who, in one of my favorite songs, he said, "Talk to me nicely. Next to blow, I might be." This man was not lying when he said that, because he is blowing up. I mean, literally, 2020... going since then, he's been going crazy. You may have heard him on your favorite rapper Kendrick Lamar's album on Die Hard. You may have heard him lately on a track with Larry June going crazy. Oh man, like this, he's so talented. I'm talking about producing, rapping, singing, songwriting, like, and other ventures too that we're gonna get into. I could name all the things that you've done all day, but Blast, welcome to Community Voices, man. How you doing?
I'm doing good, bro. That was a crazy introduction. Thank you for having me.
For sure. No, thank you for joining, man. Like I said, all those things that I've mentioned, I know that keeps you busy, so I really appreciate your time.
For sure, man. I'm down for everything.
So now I talked about everything. I just talked about all the music that you've been doing. Like, I talked about all the artists that you've been working with and how long you've been grinding. But I said since 2020, but you've really been making music way before then. You've been dabbling into it, being self-taught way before then. I think you've been making your first beat since you were like 16, which is like half of your life. You've been doing this stuff. So I would love to know, having been in music and having a passion for music for so long, how have you like managed to keep that art, that love for the art of music alive all this time? And kind of how do you see that affecting your music creation today?
Man, I would say just allowing life to run its course, bro. Like, I'm not the artist that's in the studio 24/7. People may think that, but you know, I got a regular life too. I'm a father as well. So I think, but you know, also a lot has been going on. I've been traveling the world, seeing different cultures, learning how to manage the new success I've been stepping into. So that's what keeps me inspired. But, being that I'm not in the studio, I just try to be real present in my everyday life so I can process the good and the bad and, articulate that through the music.
I totally feel that. I definitely hear a lot of artists, especially the greats, always kind of say, because people complain, you know, artists come and go, or it's been a long time since we heard them and stuff like that. But they always say the key thing is sometimes you got to like live life. Like, music always comes from a place of like living. So I can definitely see that balance of like living life and then having something to talk about, but still balancing out those two things. Because like you said, you're a father, you're a musician, you know what I'm saying? You play many roles. So I totally get that.
Yeah, they say art imitates life. So I try to keep that in mind.
Exactly. That's the only way to relate too, is to keep that kind of circle going for sure. Now, in 2020, I talked about your official debut album, which was No Love Lost. And I mean, from that same year and beyond, it just took off. I was seeing your name everywhere. I was hearing the songs everywhere on social media. It was just going completely up. I would love to kind of just know, you know, because you've had another album since then. Mm-hmm. And so what does it feel like to release your first album? And then what is it like to just see how people reacted and see how your peers were reacting and seeing all the opportunities that it ended up opening up for you, just from the people that who are listening to your music to the peers that are around you that you now make music with and record with?
Man, honestly, thinking back, bro, like, I didn't realize the weight that first project would even carry. Like, that was just my introduction to be like, let me start off my catalog. And that was No Love Lost. But to see it chosen, which is on a project, almost double platinum in the U.S., platinum in 5 different countries, Overrated went gold. Just to know that I recorded these songs in my one-bedroom apartment in Inglewood is wild, you know? But it was the foundation now to everything that I do, like how I structure my business, how I'm able to tour now. So I'm just glad I bet on myself.
That's so crazy. Just to hear you talk about just the status of that, and then just think about where it was recorded to the like accomplishments that it's received. You have to probably think about that all the time somehow when you're making new music and it's taking it to these places. Like, this is where it all started.
For real, bro. Yeah, you're right.
That's so wild. Right. Now, one of my favorite projects of yours, I mean, and I say first album is fire, but this project too, the last album, before you go. That album, let me tell you something. I love that album. And I'm talking about love that album. Like, I press play on the first track and then just let it go. Like, there is no skips. There is no, like, only his, this whole way play through. I love that album. And I would love to kind of know too, it's the sophomore album too, in a way. I know people always have this thing about sophomore album, but the sophomore album was one of the best sophomore albums I've heard in a minute.
Thank you.
From the concepts to the process of the album, the construction of it, and making it, kind of like, what did you notice and what do you feel were your biggest areas of growth compared to recording your first album to recording this most recent album? Like, what do you feel that growth in those areas of lessons that you learned in that 1 to 2 year time span?
I would say the difference just being in real time around that time, the growth really stemmed from just understanding my position. Like this was around the time where I signed a label deal as well, and I'm bringing on other artists and other producers as well. So stepping into that CEO role and kind of blending that in the music, like you hear me speaking on it and still on my way or talk to me nicely, where it's like I'm taking this leadership role. That was the biggest thing, and just learning how to prepare myself for the future. Like me and the Eagle team always planning out stuff and just trying to pace myself because I know a lot is coming my way, you know?
Yeah, I could definitely. Yeah, that's a good point. Because you still hear the hunger, like this, like that passion that I've always kind of mentioned that you've had. You hear that in the music, but it's also like that like, I don't know. It's the balance of the artistry, like knowing that there's more to come, and like you don't want to give it all away on the second album, but like
Yeah.
you're aware of what is to come, what is the like implications of the albums and the music and all that kind of stuff. So it's to have be on your second album, and now you have a label. I mean, we'll talk about it in a little bit, but you got a venture product that you're going to and a whole other side of the business. Like
Yeah.
that is a crazy way or a fast time actually to elevate in that, 1 to 2 year time frame of people being introduced to you. So I could definitely kind of understand
Yeah.
that balance of how do I balance all that.
For sure, even on top of that, like you got to think I'm releasing my second project and I haven't even done a world tour yet. So around this time, it's like I'm still learning how to maintain my energy and still be able to give my all when it's time to tour. Because this lifestyle can drain, and you still got to show up and it's a
Yeah.
lot of expectations. So just trying to stay prepared to my best ability. I think that's the best tool I can use.
100%, 100%. And now we talked about the two albums, and when we say you dropped two albums, it seems like, oh, it's not a lot, but you've been creating music, you've been on features. I mean, you had the Six Tape Two. That's a whole nother, side of music that you've been doing too. You've worked with legends, like legends to me especially, but I think legends in the game in general. I mean, Rick Ross, Dom Kennedy. We don't talk about how legendary Dom Kennedy is enough. Ty Dolla $ign, and of course, I keep mentioning his name, Kendrick Lamar. Die Hard, instant classic for me. Like I was telling my homie about that the other day. I was like, "Hey, remember the song?" Da-da-da? Yeah, he just finished the whole other side of the lyrics of the hook. Like it is such a
Oh,
perfect song. I would love to know what was it like working with Kendrick and his team on that track, and what have you been learning from like collaborating and working just like getting game from all these different legends and artists you worked with throughout this time.
man, I would say it's unreal, dog. Just you got to think like these was artists that I had on my playlist. Now I'm on their track list, so.
That's
It's
crazy, the bar.
coming full circle, but I think working with legends just ensured me that being authentic to yourself it will take you the furthest. Nobody can be Blast better than Blast, and I'm understanding my role, and I'm trying to play it to my best ability. I think my role is bridging the gap, and I guess I'll speak on that, but that's where I'm at with it right now. That's what I feel like my role is bridging the gap.
100%. Did you at any point like, did you have that moment where you're like, wow, like I'm, some people were like, oh, if I ever met Andre, if I ever met Frank Ocean, I'd be like, yo, I can't, I'd still fan out. Like, have you had an artist like that yet where you're just like, yo, I'm really working with this, but this is crazy. I gotta calm it down.
Not during the time, but it mainly be after the song, 'cause it hit me later. It's a trippy feeling though.
I bet I can't. I 100%, but that has to be wild. And what's great, and like too, I want to say too, like with all these collaborations that I mentioned too, you are holding your own on that track. It reminds me of early T-Pain when he was on everything, and when you were just like, damn, like he's getting on these tracks, but he's like elevating them. And it's like I
Yeah.
feel like the same way. Like every time I see you in a collaboration with an artist, it's like he's not just on this track for a collaboration, but he's like elevating the song. Like the song is now getting better, whether it's the hook or like it's just getting better. So like the way you handle collaborations, I have to say, is just Perfect, bro.
Thank
You're
you.
killing it.
Thank you, bro. Strategic for sure. It's becoming a trend now where artists reach out and then I work with them. They like, yo, we want to follow up for this to be the lead single. I'm like, oh. But you know, it's a gift and a curse, but I still gotta maintain my personal catalog as well. I'm
100%.
mindful of that.
100%. I totally feel that. Now, I want to talk about the donation. So we're going to be donating 10K to LA-based Education is Key organization. We want to make sure we continue to help the organizational efforts to fundraise money for scholarships for inner city students in LA. For those who may not be aware of Education is Key, they promote education and provide examples of self-sufficiency for the community, which is extremely important. And that kind of brings me to my next piece, because the world knows you as Blast, but we talked about it a little bit earlier. Your son sees you as, a superhero. He sees you as a father, one of your most important roles too. And can you kind of speak to, as a dad, can you speak to the importance of not just education, but the opportunities of being self-taught and furthering education in your own way too, and just like the power in community building for the youth?
Man, I think it's very important. Community is, this is where I'm from. So it's like, if I don't give back, then who am I? Like, I got examples like Nipsey Hussle, where he preached buying a block back, So it's like, how can I ignore those type of gems? And things like financial literacy, it's like, it's important. A lot of times we mistake financial literacy for like making money versus managing money,
Right.
and they both play a part, but I think we forget the part that we have to manage the money too, and that goes into like saving and investing. And for me, it speaks to me because I got kids, bro. It's bigger than me, I want my kids to reap the benefits from the seeds that I sow now, so it's priority.
Now, man, that's a perfect transition to what I was about to ask you next, because I was on social a couple of weeks ago. I'm a big fan of Nipsey Hussle. Since the early days, since like, I don't know if you remember, but back in the day when it was like the Currency and Wiz and that whole mixtape Dat Pimp era way back on, found Nip that way and has been a fan ever since. But I was watching some clips always surface of like past interviews he did, which I love. And one of the interviews that he did, he had a quote where he said that Rick Ross once told him that you measure success by people that you bless. Now, as someone who is progressing in multiple endeavors and careers, you have family. You have staff, other people around you who you have to support. What does that sentiment mean to you?
Man, I got a similar bar. We call it success when your circle is all rich. Even seeing Dame Dash, he preached something like, if everybody got $100,000 in my circle, if 10 people got $100,000, I can fall off and the homie will pick me back up. It's quite simple. Like we all won at the end of the day. So I think it's equally important that your team is just as in that position as you are, or at least you gotta reciprocate that energy. It can't just be about one. You gotta lean on your peoples.
100%. I definitely agree with that. I think people think too sometimes like you have to get there first to be able to help everybody. But really, like you touch so many people on the way up that like there are things that you can do even in the meantime to still like build up community or put people in position or give people certain resources to like thrive and where they want to. You know what I mean? So that's definitely important. That bar you said too, like I'm telling you,
Man.
that's a key. Community is always a big piece, I think, especially when you are someone of your caliber. People are always going to be like, well, what is he doing for the community? What is he doing
Yeah.
for the neighborhood he
Yep.
came for? So you always, even though you don't, some people don't want to be role models, but at the end of the day,
Yeah.
like it's kind of like part of the description. It happens. So it's definitely taking care of community is key.
Yeah.
Now, you're, like I said, CEO of Eagle Records, Eagle Ventures. I think newly Eagle Ventures is pretty new, right? But about maybe.
Yeah, that's another system we added on to Eagle as well. Yeah.
And then on top of that, you mentioned you signing other artists. I mean, you have a whole another revenue stream or a whole another avenue of merchandising and product. That's a whole another thing as well. These key streams that you have to really like help build, and those things support the people around you as well. Can you kind of take me through your vision for Eagle Records and just like the Eagle name in general, and where do you envision it being in the next like 5 to 10 years?
Mm.